Hello and welcome to Enterprise Tech India Unplugged. And I hope all of you are doing well. After the second wave is ebbing, people are feeling more relaxed and things are returning back to normal, although lockdowns are still continuing in all these places. So today we have a very interesting discussion and an interesting panel. Of course, we have Kumaran, who is our chief mentor and CTO for Tiny Magic. And we have Sudhar, who is also the head of technology at Tiny Magic. And he's a brilliant engineer. Nishant, who works with IBS Software and is an architect. And he leads a team of engineers who develop exciting software for airlines industry, I believe. And Kumaran does a very interesting show called Saturday Architecture. And I participate on it regularly, and I encourage you all to listen to those interesting conversations if you are interested in technology and implementation and architecture and all the issues around that. I highly recommend subscribing to that show, including this one, as we are available on YouTube and Apple Podcast and Google Podcasts. So we have a very informal way of having our conversation, and please contribute to the conversation on YouTube or LinkedIn, even Facebook sometimes, although not many followers on Facebook. So Kumaran, so the topic we are talking about is, how does citizen developer initiatives impact the governance of IT, right? How does it really change the scenario with so many people developing their own applications? How is this application sprawl going to impact the governance?
That's a tough problem with this, right? Like, so previously, if you look at it, like, let's say I had an ERP solution. Okay. All the data, right? Let's say I have let's take, for example, something like I need a price list, right, to make a quotation. Now, let's say I'm in a price-sensitive industry, how I price my raw material makes all the difference from my customer or my competitor. So now, because I have, let's say, this low-code kind of a thing, let's say that pricing is just exposed as an API, okay, which means, like, somebody can get it into an Excel, somebody can get it into a Power App, somebody possibly might use Power Automate. Somebody might write their own lightweight Angular JS or some other low code platform, okay, and use this API to get the price. Okay. Now the challenge, as let's say the organization owner, my key thing is how I am able to negotiate a good price from my vendor. Okay, if this price gets into my competitor's hand, I have lost my advantage, because the rest in my industry is assumed that it's a commodity. So till today, because it was in ERP, nobody could have access to that. When they click a button like click quotation, that would come up. So I'm giving a very practical case of a data which is key to my organization. Now that data is now available with a lot more people in the company, and I don't know how to control that. Okay, it can go out anywhere. That's one kind of thing. The other thing that happens is, let's say I write simple solutions and I hand it over to my teammate. He does some changes and hands it over to his teammate. Okay, and it keeps going. Now, over a period of time, a group has started using the solution for a long time. Okay. They've got used to it. They've got done that. Now they are like 1 month into that. And the developer who started that, who did that initial modification, right? He's actually a business user. So let's assume he's a HR executive. Mm-hmm. Okay. And in recruitment, they were using to manage. So he had done that small changes and they are all using it. Now that person leaves and goes. Okay, there is no knowledge transfer. There is nothing that has happened. Now that team, that application crashes for some reason. It doesn't work. Okay, that that small solution, point solution stopped working. They are stuck. That group cannot function. They become dysfunctional anymore. It's like one attack that happens. Okay. So that is a kind of worrying thing. Now, what I'm telling is not happening yet, right? Mm-hmm. Probably you go down this citizenship development, 2-3 years later, this will start happening. And then there is, then of course it becomes little more easier if for malintentioned people, right? Like somebody could just do a small tweak and kind of get out data that is being entered into an application and things like that. So how do you, so these things, right? Like, so I have one small app. Now there are 10 different departments, each of them tweak it, right? Now I have 10 variants of this application, okay? And each one mutates, each variant mutates itself, okay? Now, in a classical world, I would have had one application. So it was easier to deal with. I knew what it did as an IT guy, right? Ultimately, it will be a technology's responsibility. Now, this becomes a problem on controlling.
Okay. So, Sudha, you have any experience on...
And finally, what will happen is the business will come and say, oh, this is an IT solution. IT solve it for us. This is bush. I never touched this. I don't know even this animal existed here. Okay. So, the Covishield vaccine was found, was done for version B. Now, somebody is telling version 1.2.6, it is not against.
Hmm.
How can a Covaxin or a Covishield be held responsible that it's not working against the variant B126?
Yes, yes. So, sir, what is your opinion on this control problem?
So, I think there is always this working relationship that happens between the business and the IT team, right? So it's mostly about like whether the IT team should facilitate the business team conducting the business, or it should be the IT team protect the business from shooting itself food, or it should kind of basically provide enough functionality for the business so that they can do it on their own. I think it's something which that the way that relationship works, I think it differs from companies to companies. And I think the perfect would be where both go hand in hand. It's not like the IT team tries to control the infrastructure aspect, which is being used by the business. Because at the end of the day, the business team is going to be knowing about the business more than what the IT team can predict. Could be the future case, right? So I feel it's an interesting thing. It's something which would evolve over a period of time in any company. And for it to work perfectly, I feel like it has to go hand in hand, rather than one team saying, like, I'm more important for the long-term survival of the company.
Nishant, what is your experience on this aspect of controlling data, controlling access, all kinds of governance issues related to citizen developers?
Yeah, in my view, when we have to get into this world, like, because now I can strongly say, like, we haven't fully reached into this stage, like, the business users can do all the changes they want, or minor changes they can do it by themselves. Still, this IT, they are depending on IT. So if we have to make a major shift on that, the product or the application that IT team building is, the governance should be an integral part of that product itself. Because auto governance kind of thing. Like a simple example is auditing things. Like if somebody has make some changes, this software itself should trace that things and audit it somewhere, and so that at any point of time, we can simply track what change has actually, as Kumaran said, if a number of people is making changes or tweaking the product for their own need. And finally, a small change might impact the whole ecosystem. So to track that change, we should have a mechanism, inbuilt mechanism within that product. which demands a scenario like when we build a product, a business application, this governance should be a key factor. The governance should be an integral part of that product itself. That is one thing. Or another aspect would be like the governance or the control should give to the business users in a way like we may have a central application and the users can have a customized version locally running in their machine. You may have to think how feasible. I think to an extent it's feasible because even this, we have a classic examples. When we initially had the central source control management like ClearCase and all, later now this Bitbucket or Git is a classic example, right? We have our own the distributed kind of thing, like our own versions or our own. So if we could adopt the same principle here also, like a very simple example, if I am a business user and in my machine I might run with a different theme or a different, that is purely a local thing, right? That is only visible in my machine or in my, similarly, if we could have a tweaking kind of things in that way, that we can have some kind of control on the overall things. The end object is like a small, even if we give this control to the business users to do it by themselves, it should not affect the business. It should not affect the ender or it should not affect others. That's the key thing. We can give the control, whatever the things, but we should have the proper...
That analogy that you got with GitHub, right? I think that is a very good point. So probably it's something like any solution that comes up, right? It's not like, you know, I gave it to you and you can do whatever you want. Okay.
Yeah.
It's like you give the kids phone, but you say, you know, between 9 to 5 only you will use it. Or you say, you know, you can go wherever you want, but every 2 hours you are supposed to tell me where you are. I'm giving you a phone. You don't have to ask my permission, but every 2 hours you tell me where you are.
Yes.
So the analogy is something like if somebody is doing a solution, the central IT will know something like this, a mini app or a low code app is existing here. And the second thing I think Nishant taking from what you said is something like, let's say something is getting very popular in the local thing. That means it's like, then you merge it with the main thread, which means you kind of either you give that low code back to the central IT and the central IT will now distribute it to the next department. It comes through them and not from department to department, but it comes back to the center and goes. When it comes to the center, the IT will do one audit of that, whatever is there, and then say, okay, somebody else can use it. Or, or just that one thing I will finish and then you can add. Or the other thing is because it's becoming more popular, now this functionality I will hand over to the central. Because now more than 60% of the employees are using it. Now the local guys won't touch it anymore. It will become center's responsibility. Take care of them.
Yeah, Kumana. That's, I think that is an interesting thing. Like, in a way, actually, we are giving that freedom or that innovation kind of thing to business users also. And they can create their own, I mean, customized application locally. And if the final, centrally, if we see, I mean, it's a central team or a central things can see like this is a local version running in one of the business users, and that would add value to the, definitely add, if we see like that would add value to the entire business users, as you said, we can merge that to the central things and we can publish that as a new version. Correct.
So let me sort of break this problem into small parts and let's see if we have different views on that. So the one of the most popular ways of putting these controls in place is, first of all, you don't change your access modes, right? For example, who has access to data is anyway a higher level decision. Like if you're talking about, let's say raw material pricing, right? Raw material pricing is a sensitive information for specific industries. And we know who are the people who are allowed to have access, right? This is like, who are the people who are interested in this data and who are sort of critical to have this information, right? So that is a decision you can make at a higher level. This is who has access to what data is a conceptually allocated solution, in the sense that these are the roles which need access to this information. So you provide a role-based framework to how the data is organized, right? And who has access to what data. So of course, this is the purchase department. This is the purchase department has needs to have access to this kind of data. So all these databases where purchase related information, raw material related information is there, this department has access. In this department, these are the roles who should have access, right? So you have put this framework in place and you put these controls in place at that level. So you don't place control over applications, you place control over data. Instead of restricting people from what applications you have access to, you say we restrict on what data you have access to, depending on the role which you play, right? And you keep the door open. It says if for some reason, business justifiable reason, somebody else needs this data, there should be a simple process to request for it, right? So that way it covers both control and freedom. It says, okay, I need this data. There's an automated process. If I can justify to my manager or whoever who is authorized to allow me to access to this data, I will get access to this data, right? And this, of course, because this is on a database, role-based access, all auditing is at the database level, not at the application layer, right? So application layer, people build anything, everything. If you have access to my application, but you don't have access to that, application doesn't work for you, right? So in that way, you break the connection between who is building the application. As long as they have access to data, and they are authorized for that role to have access to the data, they can build n number of applications on top of it, right? I'll give you an example of leave management system, right? A leave management system is already built on a database. It has its old IE Explorer kind of interface, which they have sort of, it's a kludge basically, right? And a lot of organizations, those are very old systems, leave management, right? Now, all employees need to have access to their own data, right? They already have it, right? That is built into the structure of that whole application, right? Now, if on top of it, somebody builds an application which allows you to apply for leave and see your balance leave and things like that, right? It's a citizen developer thing where as long as you have access to your own data, this app will work for you. This is not going to give you access to anybody else's data, but because you already have access to your own data, this is a new interface which we have just built using the Power Apps feature or whatever other platforms you might be using, right? And so there is no control breaking there, right? Because you are only the application, the citizen developer is not interfering with the structure, the framework of the access control mechanisms. Right. So this is one perspective of looking at it, that there is no real change in terms of access controls, because you already have access to the data. You're just changing the interface. So the application is, another example is, you already have access to data. All you need is to be able to generate reports out of it, right? Why do you need an application to give you reports only? You use Power BI or whatever other BI tools you have, right? And it's all, as long as I have authorized access to the data, I should be able to generate that report, right? So this is not fundamentally changing any controls as such.
So if I hear you right, what you're kind of trying is, as IT, we start looking at things in a more mature manner rather than playing all or nothing. You have access to the application or get lost.
Exactly.
Instead of that, I'm saying, okay, what is the data that you're going to look at? It's like you enter into the office or you can't enter into the office. Instead of that, telling you can come into the office, you can go into this room. This shelf is locked, this shelf is open. This room is allowed, this room is not allowed. So that kind of a granularity level check done on the data. Now that could be implemented either at the DB level or API level or whatever, right?
Yes.
Probably the IT needs to focus on that, is what you're telling, for a data secure or privacy and that kind of a perspective.
Right.
It's like you give a phone, but it has a kid's mode.
Kid's mode. That, right? The kid's mode. Yes. So I think that is the that is a most likely acceptable governance scenario, right? Because otherwise, you put anything else in place, you restrict the freedom which you are trying to give to people, right? So
I think that what you just said, right, it's kind of interesting. It is just that it's just because people do this, this gives to that point that IT has still a significant amount of work to do.
Exactly.
Right? Thinking through the data, doing a better information architecture, better data architecture, better compliance. I think they would be spending more time on that, on how to provision that and doing this rather than spending time on comparatively frivolous activities like how do I read a create, update, CRUD screen, basically.
Yes, yes. Not only that, they also need to stop thinking about solving all business problems and solving all business scenarios. IT cannot figure those things out.
Cannot figure it out. Yeah.
So they have to leave it at a place where people can treat it as a tool and sort of solve their own problems. Right. Mm. At the same time, those tools don't hurt the organization. The tools don't hurt the people. Right. So they just need to put the framework in place so that people are not able to abuse the tools.
Got it. Yeah.
So, Sudhar, you have any comments around how that is possible to be achieved?
I think, like, I don't know, like, leaving from a technical perspective, right? So, there should be, I feel like there should be a good trust that should happen between the different teams. And as you said, like, you know, trying to do it at the data layer instead of the application layer, I think makes more sense. Because at the end of the day, like whatever is the application, right? The underlying thing that should not be exposed is the data. It's not like whether somebody has access to the application. It's more towards like whether somebody has actually have access to the data. So putting the checks in the data layer and preventing, and then also like, you know, providing or opening up the application and then putting the restriction at the data layer, I think would make it more open for the business team or the other people who are not part of the IT team to make use of the data much more rather than like, you know, trying to restrict everything at the application layer.
So Nishant, yeah, any architecture advice you want to give on how to achieve this?
Yeah, here also my doubt is like we talk about this restriction from a data point of view. Like the point is when we have an application, we have this application interface as well as the user interface layer as well as the data is the key thing that from a business user point of view they are dealing with. They are entering some data and they are entering that data into a business user interface. So are we thinking in a from an IT or business people point of view, or are we thinking in a point like whether we should give control to business user to enhance that user interface screen perspective as well? Like if they have to add a custom field there to keep some value or to send some additional information to the backend layer.
Right.
Because now we are running the NoSQL kind of thing and the document DB kind of thing. So that may not be a big deal. So are we, because just now we discussed about data, I'm thinking like whether we should give such kind of control also to business users or only we should control everything with this data restriction or data kind of thing.
Right. So I'm just, of course, we cannot solve the problem on this in this session, but there are obviously different ways of looking at the problem. One is the examples so far, which I have seen for all these applications, citizen developer applications, they actually don't create new kinds of data, right? They are manipulating existing data in existing systems. So in that sense, they are not creating much new data. They are just simplifying for themselves what was already existing. The example which I gave was for leave management, right? So your leave management system already lets you add a leave, delete a leave, check all those things, right? So that those functions already exist, right? So in most cases, the easiest to control is where all the other controls already exist. They just use a different interface and make it specific to that scenario which they want to use. In terms of reporting, obviously, you make a Power BI report and you send me the link to the dashboard and say, have a look at it. But that link has no meaning to me if I don't have access to the data. So you may create the dashboard, but the control of whether I see the data inside the dashboard is depending on my role. Because my role says, I am not supposed to see this data, so I will not get access to the data. So the control is moved back to the database rather than to the application itself. So the dashboard is the dashboard. I created a dashboard, it is used. Anybody who gets the link, if he has access to the data, they see it. If they don't have access to the data, they can request for it. I can talk about it because I just faced the same thing. Somebody sent me a link. He says, here, this is the dashboard. You can use this. And they, in fact, in the dashboard, they combined data from multiple sources and showed it to me. So part of it have I access to, part of it I don't have access to. I see only half the dashboard. So those are the ways the controls are experienced by a user like me.
I think one other place where we could tap information from, I don't know, I'm not an expert in that, is people who have worked in solving MDM problem, master data management. I think we have a decade of experience around that. I think that will give us some insights into how to do that part, right? Talk to folks who have done MDM implementations or dealt with it, right? And how did they go about tackling that problem?
So I think information architecture becomes really important for enabling.
Correct.
Enabling the citizen developer governance, right? So if you have good data, so I think this may be a good check for people to see whether they are able to adopt to this. If you're advising any of your customers on how ready they are, right? So how can you check if the organization is ready for citizen developers or not? You have to see how well their information architecture is, right? Can they sustain it, right? If it is so rigid that it is tied to an application and there is no way you can access it from anywhere else, and because a lot of controls are implemented at the application layer sometimes, right? So the access is managed through the application layer and it is not done at the database layer. So those things will, I think, give you information on whether that the organization is ready for doing something like this or not. Because we keep repeating all these things, is citizen developer is here, citizen developer is, how do you check whether this organization can really do it or not? Right, so they have to go back and see whether can you really expose the data? Do you have the controls in place? Because suppose I say, okay, tomorrow we'll expose the data to everybody so that they can make their own applications, right? But is your database implementation, the schema and all those controls, are they going to enable such a change or not? I think that is what they should be an important check for people. What do you think? Do you think people are ready for it, or they are even thinking about it?
I think it's hard to say.
So the automation example which you have seen, right? What is your experience on that? Are the organization ready for a change like where you bring in these automation tools and things like that? How easy it is to manipulate the data or the...
I think just people have started talking. It seems interesting. I think the interest is there.
Okay.
And the providers are starting to generate that interest. I think
Sudhar, what is your experience? Do you think most databases or information being stored in enterprises today, are they ready for doing this kind of control?
Okay, so I don't have much of enterprise experience, but from the usually like the mid to small companies, right? I think one challenge that might happen here is most of this data is actually behind some type of framework, maybe Laravel or something like that, right? I'm not talking about enterprise solutions. Mm-hmm.
Right? Really, any application.
Yeah. So the problem there is, like as you mentioned, like a lot of these business checks, right, especially about the authorization part, is actually very closely bundled as part of the application logic itself. If you just purely look at the DB, there's going to be very limited information about like who has access to what and stuff like that. Because most of this is actually now going to be controlled at the application layer. Because again, small to mid size companies are actually not going to be coming up with a homegrown solution, but most probably be using a framework, and whatever framework that they picked up would dictate its own way of managing the underlying data. So that could be a challenge, but again, something that it could be good to explore more. But I think that the first thought that comes to my mind is that could be a challenge, or at least like, you know, if I can think of the applications that I've worked on or currently working, that's the first thing that comes to my mind. Like if I have to leave out the application part and then provide data restrictions or access restrictions at the data layer, how do I implement it? So because most of my authorization logic is already now in the application code or the application layer, right? So how do I, without going through the application, if somebody is going to directly access my DB, like how do I prevent that?
Right. I think maybe we don't need to think about it, people directly accessing the DB. We need to think about people talking to the data access layer, maybe, right?
Yeah, I mean,
and look, people thinking about building that whole authorization logic into the API, which will enable access to the database, right? So instead of people talking directly to the database, so this probably goes back to what is the architecture of your application, did you really build a data access layer, right? Because that depends completely on the software architects, how they design the application. So applications which have that access layer and they can build an API which will sort of pseudo do what the application was doing on access control, those are the things which might impact.
It leads us to the place where compute specialists have to really do some compute work.
Yes.
They cannot do this makeup lipstick work and get away. You really have to think hard, and they really have to say, okay, this is the data. How do I get it out? For example, it could be I will, like in the example that I was talking, to generate a quote, I need not know the price, but I need the list of items. So previously I made it easy, right? I just said product, item, price. Done. Okay. Now I have to say, okay, if you want product, I will give you a list of products, but I won't give you the price of them. There is a separate API for that, a separate control for that. Do you want how many quantity is left in stock? There is a separate API for it. Who needs to know that? So I think that level of specialization is where the IT team should be spending their energy on.
Right. So I think that's a good point to conclude on. I think there is a lot of effort that needs to go into enabling citizen developer applications, the whole framework. I think the feeling which I get is a lot of organizations have not thought through that yet. And this is a time where they should think about how their information architecture is built, how their data is stored, how access management is done, whether all applications have those layers which will enable those APIs, or do they need to start building those APIs? Right. So those are the things which IT should start thinking about if they have to really latch on to this bandwagon of citizen developers, because otherwise it will just remain leave applications only, right? So they will not go beyond that. So I think that's a good conclusion, that there is still a lot of work that IT needs to do to enable this governance, to put those controls in place. And there are a lot of challenges. And Sudhar has mentioned, Nishant has mentioned, and of course, this, and we'll see, we'll keep tracking this progress of how people are adopting and adapting to these changes. So I hope you have found this conversation as interesting as we did when we did it. So please give your feedback, and see you next time.